welcomes you back to the Homestead Miami Speedway for continuing coverage of Championship Weekend. It's time for Busch Pole qualifying on this mile-and-a-half racetrack. Let's take a look at the point standings heading into the final race of this 2005 season. Martin Truex Jr. leads Clint Bowyer by 64 points. Again, the last race of this 2005 season, staring them in the face. Let's go to Marty Snyder with the defending champion and current points leader, Martin Truex Jr.
And for him, the math is fairly simple, Steve. 12th or better, and he wins the championship. So have you had time to relax this weekend? Did you sleep at all?
Oh, yeah. I don't have any problem sleeping. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter what the circumstances are. But, you know, we'll just see. Our Bass Pro Chevy was decent yesterday. I don't think it's going to be too good in qualifying. It'll probably be pretty loose. So this track seems to get real, real tight after a few laps on the tires. And we just, I guess we're kind of semi-throwing away qualifying. We made a run last night. We were real fast, but we had to free it up since then. So we'll just get what we can, and hopefully we'll have a good day here.
Well, Martin already has one win today, guys. He won the Bass Pro Shops fishing tournament inside the lake. That's another win he wanted also. Bob Dillner.
Marty, Clint Bowyer just chilling out. Really no pressure. At least he's not feeling any. 64 markers behind in this championship chase. But you said, hey, you're just going for it this weekend, aren't you?
Yeah, absolutely. The real car guys. We've been working really hard on this car, and I got the AC Delco lady right over my shoulder, so I got to get that plug in there. But, you know, just this exciting weekend, you know, just excited to have a chance at this thing, and real proud of the guys that get me here. So it's just up to me to go out there and get the job done. Really, you know, important to get a good qualifying run in there, and I think we can do that. Car was really stable in their mock qualifying run, and I think it'll race good, so we just got to, you know, go full speed ahead and see how it comes out. You never know.
Has it been frustrating, though, to be ahead of Martin Truex Jr. for, I think it's like 6 out of the past 9 races, yet at the same time, hardly gaining any ground?
Yeah, I mean, it's we've been beating him. You know, the whole second half of the year, we've beat him pretty steadily. And, you know, just the couple times that we didn't were, you know, were big hits and points for us. You know, Charlotte just a few weeks ago was a huge hit, and you know, we've just been trying to bounce back. We've been doing a really good job of it, but it was just a really big hit right there in points. So, you know, it comes down to this. You just got to go at it as hard as we can and, you know, get everything out of it we possibly can. And if we do that, those are the things we can control. And we can't control, you know, what they do and what they got going on in this race. So just got to make sure we do everything we can do. And as far as the things that we got going on, if we do that, it gives us a chance.
Clint Bowyer and the AC Delco boys not giving up. He'll roll off 27th today in qualifying.
All right, thanks a lot, Bob. Let's take a look. As you heard, Martin Truex Jr., if he finishes 12th or better, it doesn't matter what Clint Bowyer does. If Martin Truex Jr. leads a lap, he can finish 14th or better and still clinch his second championship. Hi, everybody. Welcome back to the Homestead Miami Speedway. Steve Burns alongside Larry Mack and Jeff Hammond. And Larry McReynolds, you've said this for several weeks. Clint Bowyer just keeps taking little bites.
Yeah, I mean, as the graphic's shown, he has beaten him about 7 out of the last 9 races. But it's just been those little hits. But I talked about it last week at Phoenix. One of the real difference in this points lead that Martin Truex Jr. has is he has 40 more bonus points than Clint Bowyer. And that's points for leading a lap or leading the most lap. And that's huge when you're only looking at a 60-point lead, 62-point lead. But what Clint Bowyer has to do is pretty much it's Hail Mary. You've got to go out there, you've got to lead all the laps and win the race and see what happens with Martin Truex Jr. in his 8 car.
And Jeff Hammond, Martin Truex Jr. said earlier this weekend, I'm going to keep things simple, but this is a fast racetrack. It's been reconfigured. It has progressive banking, and we've seen even the best of drivers have problems. Last night in final practice, Tony Stewart went for a ride off of turn 2.
Well, I think it just goes to show right now what Martin was talking about is what happened to Tony Stewart. He's trying to get his car free enough so he can get off the corner, and it basically got away from him last night. He did an excellent job of keeping it off the wall. But our point leader in the Nextel Cup Series, you know, he just, again, it can happen to the best of them. And I mean, when you think about the best of the best, you got to think about Tony Stewart. Martin Truex has got to not beat himself. That's what you need to make sure you don't have happen to him. And you don't need to be able to put yourself in a bad position, as Brandon Witt did. He got inside of the 88 truck right there. Air got took off him. He went for a ride. Luckily, nobody got into the side of the 38 truck. He was able to continue. But these are the kind of things that you don't need to have happen at the end of the race. Also, you do all day long. You try to kind of keep your nose clean. And right there at the end of the race, right there, Joey Miller and several trucks got together in the Craftsman truck race. Again, took some key people out of very valuable positions as far as points are concerned. He can't afford to have any problems. And the biggest thing, Steve, don't beat yourself.
And we saw action from the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series race that took place earlier this morning. Todd Bodine won the race. Congratulations to Ted Musgrave for clinching his first ever NASCAR title. We'll take a break now. We'll come back with you and get ready for Busch Pole qualifying from the Homestead Miami Speedway. Hope you're enjoying Speed's coverage of Championship Weekend.
One final race, one final shot, one Nextel Cup champion. 10 races culminate in one final shootout for the Nextel Cup championship, and only Speed is live, covering all the action. From Miami, the biggest week in NASCAR.
Man, these guys are crazy.
With NASCAR Nation, backseat drivers, the chase is on. Trackside, but pole qualifying, NASCAR This Morning, NASCAR Victory Lane, and more.
Oh!
Plus, Sunday, the biggest pregame show NASCAR has ever seen.
It's crazy all over town.
Covering every possible angle.
This is a pretty interesting story.
Speed will be on the air live before the biggest race of the year.
This is an exciting time.
No question about that.
From pre-race warm-ups to post-race burnouts, Speed puts you in the middle of it all.
Door-to-door, beating and banging.
If you're not watching NASCAR on Speed, you're not watching NASCAR. Championship Week continues all weekend on Speed.
Getting set for Busch Pole qualifying here in Homestead, the Homestead Miami Speedway. There's a large field of teams here and drivers, 53 in all, are expected to try to qualify for this race. Only 43 spots. Those are the drivers that need to make it in on time. Also in yellow, the past Busch Series champions are highlighted. You see Joe Nemechek in the 87, the only driver to win more than one race here on this racetrack. He's been to Victory Lane three times.
Now, actually, Brian Vickers is a past champion, but he is not eligible for the past champion provisional because he did not compete in a Busch Series race in 2004.
Well, hopefully for him, he won't have to worry about that. He'll be able to qualify on time. But as we look at the guys who do, you know, I think you'll also notice there are a lot of Nextel Cuppers this week running here, pulling double duty. Almost 20 total guys trying to attempt the double.
Jeff, one of those drivers got his very first Busch Series win here. That is Casey Kane. He's with Bob Dillner.
That's right. That was 2 years ago, Steve. And he won the Truck Series race here last year. So Homestead, a very good racetrack for Casey Kane. But how is this Busch Series car going to be in qualifying here today?
I think it should be good. We didn't make a qualifying run yesterday in the Lowry's Dodge Charger, but made a lot of race runs. Feel like we have a real good car for tonight. And you know, put tape on it, and hopefully it'll just create a better car and go fast.
Interesting practice sessions yesterday early on. You had some cloud cover, and then yesterday late in the dark. And now today, I see the sun peeking through. What's that going to mean?
Well, the weather's been changing a lot here. You know, hopefully it doesn't rain anymore. We got to keep the rain away and get this weekend over with. But, you know, it's been different track conditions. The rain's washed the rubber off, and they, you know, have blown the track back off and got it dried, and it changes it a lot. So after the truck race, it'll probably be similar to how it was yesterday afternoon, I'd imagine, or yesterday night. And, you know, we'll look forward to being pretty close to how we were.
Casey Kane, a roll off 22nd here today. Marty?
Well, you'd be hard-pressed to find someone hotter in the Busch Series than Carl Edwards. Four straight top five finishes, including last week's win. I bet you don't want this season to end, do you?
No, I'm having a blast. Our whole charter team's been doing a great job. Phoenix was just unreal. That was about the most fun race I've been in a long time. I mean, that was real racing.
And it's been a rough day for the Roush crew today, and the passing of John Reiser, Robbie Reiser's father, really instrumental in getting this Busch Series program at Roush Racing started.
Yeah, it's unbelievable. You're the first one to tell me what happened this morning. Brad was trying to hide it from me. John's an unbelievable guy. You know, we dedicated that win in Texas, our cup car, to John. The only regret I have is I didn't actually get to go see him and give him the trophy. So, man, that's tough. We're all thinking about his family. He's one of the... Just a true man, a good man, someone I really look up to.
John Reiser, one of the true gentlemen of this sport, guys.
Yeah, thanks a lot. Appreciate that, Marty. Bad news indeed. John Reiser, Robbie Reiser's father. Robbie is the crew chief for Matt Kenseth. And Robbie and Matt have been together for many years, used to race against each other up in Wisconsin, and that's been a close relationship.
Well, he really has. And, you know, echo the same thing that Carl Edwards was talking about. A classic gentleman, very instrumental in getting his son, Robbie, into racing. Robbie, at one time driver, decided that, hey, you know, he'd be better off putting someone else behind the wheel to continue the racing tradition of their family, and a good move with Matt Kenseth, and that relationship has been well documented. And again, Robbie, my condolences to you and your entire family on the death of your father.
And I think everyone's hit the nail on the head. John Reiser was a racer, and he certainly will be missed around the garage area.
All of us at Speed convey our thoughts and prayers to the father or the family of John Reiser. We'll be back to Homestead, Miami for Busch Bowl qualifying. Getting set for the first car to roll out for Busch Bowl qualifying here in Homestead. 53 drivers on hand to qualify, just 43 spots in this field. Larry McReynolds, Jeff Hammond, let's talk about track conditions. Casey Kane alluded to that. We've had rain off and on. There was a truck race here already this morning. How will that affect qualifying?
I mean, this is a very unpredictable track regardless. But when you throw in the fact that these guys have not been on the racetrack since yesterday afternoon or early yesterday evening, and we had a downpour last night, we've had the truck race, there's going to be a lot of guessing. And we're going to follow this track temperature a lot during this qualifying session right now at 93 degrees.
And Larry, I noticed during the truck race, a lot of the Busch Series crew chiefs had their headsets on, were listening to other crew chiefs working the truck race, trying to pick up on what the racetrack was doing. Even though a truck and a car is considerably different, you want to understand maybe what the track is like so you can make those air pressure adjustments. And the guys that were going out early, they're probably thinking, man, this is going to be good. Track's going to be cooler than what it's going to be an hour from now. But with this race just being run here, less than 30 minutes ago, the truck race was concluded. All of a sudden, there may be something on that racetrack you're not ready for.
Let's talk about this racetrack just a little bit. The Busch cars first came here in 1995. This racetrack has went through two or three configuration changes. One major change a couple of years ago. It used to be a mile and a half Indianapolis look with four distinct corners and four different straightaways. Now it's a true oval with what we call progressive banking. Down here at the bottom, it starts at 6 degrees, and it works itself up. It's 6 degrees here. By the time you're up here, it's 20 degrees. And I think even during this qualifying session, you'll see some cars qualifying off the bottom of the racetrack, unlike a lot of the mile-and-a-half racetracks we go to.
I think what you're going to see, Larry, you're right, but I think those drivers, they'd like to run around the bottom of the racetrack. But the key thing is right now, you have a racetrack that you can let the car kind of run up, stay in the throttle, and make some good time. So don't be surprised you see some guys run around the bottom, see some of the guys run right through the middle of the turn, depending on how the car is working for them, and they're going to drive it by the seat of their pants and let it happen.
Let's check in quickly with Bob Dillner.
Hey, Hollywood, here's one guy that always drives by the seat of his pants, Reed Sorensen, and he is looking good in Homestead, third quick in that final practice session. And Reed, you were just telling me you think you have a shot at the pole today.
I think we got a pretty good shot. The car's been really loose since we got here, and I think we worked on it and got a little bit better, and hopefully it won't be as loose here in a qualifying run. But yesterday when we did that lap in practice, this was my second lap, which was kind of surprising. But we'll see what we got here. I don't know what the track's going to be like being the third car out, but could be good, could be bad, but we'll see what we do.
Hollywood and Larry, Matt Kerchies, I want to ask you a question. If it was loose yesterday for Reed Sorensen under the conditions that we saw, how about today under these sunny skies?
I don't like the thought process of that. I heard some of the guys in the truck division that the track was getting kind of free, and a lot of that could be just because of the sun getting ready to come back on here. Out on the racetrack, it's fairly warm right now. Even though we got a little bit of cloud cover, the sun keeps breaking through, and that's going to pull some oils up out of the racetrack and make it a little bit greasy.
But I think one reason so many of these teams were hesitant, especially the 30 teams that are in the top 30 in owner points that's locked in the show, they were so hesitant to free that car up. They know the characteristics of this race. Track into this 300-mile race later on this afternoon is it will get tighter and tighter. The front end will slide more and more.
Joe Nemechek won the pole position for the very first NASCAR Busch Series race here. As Larry said, run back in 1995. Been to victory lane three times.
This would be be a pretty good test because he usually doesn't hold back a whole lot. So I would look for Joe Nemechek to kind of test his track out early on and give the rest of these guys a pretty good idea of what they can expect.
Yeah, he's normally pretty solid here, not only in the race, but in qualifying. He has 10 Busch Series starts here, 4 top 5 starts in qualifying.
He was 10th quickest in the final practice yesterday. So let's see if he can back up what he did. And again, we'll get some idea of what kind of speed is the racetrack early on.
And Jeff, I walked through the garage area this morning as Joe Nemechek completes his first lap at a 31:27. So he's actually already quicker than he ran in that final practice. And I kind of took a poll. You know, we always talk about sticker or brand new tires or tires that have been scuffed, had a little time on them. And it was almost a split decision between the garage area, but it's almost like whatever your car liked. Did it want the new sticker tires, or did it want tires that maybe had been scuffed just a little bit?
And I think we need to make sure, also mention that these guys are in an impound situation, so the setup underneath these cars is what they're going to race here in just a few hours. So, you know, whatever you got your car and how you got it balanced out could be very instrumental as far as how quick you run and what kind of tires you choose. And he does pick it up just a little bit on that second lap, 31:26, and pretty good lap right there as far as that. That should give a guy like Reed Sorensen a little bit of momentum as far as thinking. He can sit on the pole. Hey, I can go out there and lay on this racetrack. It's taken it so far.
And just to let you know, our championship points leader, Martin Truex Jr., will qualify or was scheduled to go out 14th. And as Bob Dillner mentioned, Clinton Bowyer scheduled to go out 27th. Up next, the number 10 car, that's Johnny Andretti on board, making just his second career NASCAR Busch Series start.
I was told this morning that the one reason they put John Andretti in this 10 car, normally Brent Sherman drives a 10. Brent's actually in the 15 Busch Series car here this weekend, that this will be a full-time program for John Andretti in 2006.
Well, that's good for John. We know that he's got a lot of talent, former winner as far as Cup Series is concerned, and it's always good to have him back around the racetrack. Got a chance to speak to him just a little bit this morning, and he had a big old smile on his face, and I think he was really excited about getting the opportunity to get back in a race car full time.
Jeff, is this the kind of racetrack, thinking in recent weeks, where we've seen some drivers go one and done, one lap and then shut it down? Is this a place where you want that momentum of a second lap?
I think it was almost like the tire decision. It was almost like 50-50. I talked to some teams in practice yesterday. Their fast lap was lap one. I talked to some of their fast lap was lap two.
Watching John right here coming to the green, guys. Carl wiggled around right in the middle of three and four right there coming to take the green. So makes you wonder right there, Larry, maybe he's got new tires on again. He's up about the middle groove right now coming through one and two.
And this is a go-or-go-home car. He has to get in on his time.
And you mentioned Brett Sherman. News came to light this week that Brent will replace Kenny Schrader in the number 49 car in the Nextel Cup Series next year. And Schrader announced that he is, in fact, going to the Wood Brothers number 21. And they debuted a brand-new primary sponsor, Little Debbie Cakes, on the hood of that 21 car.
Now, John was 18th quickest in final practice at a 31:58. This car is not in the racetrack. You can see him walking up, and I think he pretty much has had enough. But that could be somewhat borderline. He slowed down about 2.5 tenths from what he ran in practice.
I think he maybe should have went for the second lap. He could have held his breath a little bit longer on that one, Larry.
Marty Snyder.
Well, let's ask Joe Nemechek, the first guy out. How was the racetrack, Joe?
See, a lot of people would like to know. Which...
Sure they would, wouldn't they? And you don't want to tell them, do you?
Say, we made a lot of adjustments. Gary Putnam, my whole crew, I mean, it's been working hard. It's our last race with Cellular One. Still trying to get some money for next year, but we got a great race team, and things are going good. We had a great test down here. I think that was a pretty good qualifying lap. I may have overdrove turn one just a little bit, but I think it's pretty decent lap.
And Joe has a seven-year winning streak. He's won a race for 7 straight years in the Busch Series. Trying to continue that today is not one yet. This year, Pete.
Marty, we do not know what the racetrack is like. He pretty much answered everything but that. He knows a lot of people are in their trailers watching this broadcast right now.
Reed Sorensen, the youngster with Ganassi Racing, trying to pick up his third pole of the year. He won from the pole at Nashville earlier this season and also took a pole position at Indianapolis Raceway Park.
Now, he and Carl Edwards, not only are they battling for the third position in points right now, Reed is fourth, but they are also battling for the Robestus Rookie of the Year. They are only separated by 11 points right now. Carl Edwards leading that battle with this final race to go. And his first lap, 31.38 for the 41 car.
That's slower than what he ran yesterday. He's about 2/10 slower than what he ran. So let's see what he can do here on the second lap. Car didn't look that bad. His tires are gripping like he wants them to right now.
Now, Reed's one of the drivers attempting double duty here this weekend. He's trying to qualify the 09 Dodge for James Finch in the Phoenix Racing Team in the Nextel Cup.
Jeff, what did you count? 13 full-time Nextel Cup drivers attempting to qualify for this race?
Yes, sir. 13 full-time guys. And when you look at some of the boys like Reed Sorensen who are over there trying to qualify, like I say, totals up to 20 drivers trying to do the double.
It's been an impressive season for the 19-year-old of Peachtree City, Georgia. We go back to Bob Dillner.
All right, David Rudiman, teammates with Michael Waltrip here. And David led a good portion of the early part of the Truck Series race here this morning at Homestead Miami Speedway. But now your boss, Michael's on the racetrack. And I saw you talking to him. Did you give him any pointers?
Well, I don't. We just talked about a lot of stuff besides that. I don't know if I'm qualified to give Michael Waltrip any pointers. But we're here in the second Aaron's Dream Machine entry this week. And hopefully we'll get her in a race. We don't have any points, so we'll have to get in on time.
How are you and Michael? How have you guys been here at Homestead this weekend?
Not too bad. Haven't had the opportunity to make a lot of laps, but I think we're not bad.
Not bad. Very simply said. Steve?
All right. Thanks a lot, Bob Dillner. And his boss man, Michael Waltrip, on the racetrack, attempting to make his 18th race of this 2005 season.
Now, with the goofy weather we had here yesterday, the Busch Series actually had three very short practice sessions. Now, Michael was ninth in the second practice, but elected not to run that final practice last night. So as he's trying to complete his lap one, this is a team, I think the biggest thing they want to do is qualify for this race. They have missed a lot of races this year with this 99 car. First lap, 31.78. That puts him third quickest.
Larry, I was watching inside of Michael's car, and I could see him really working the wheel like a car. And we're going to say this a lot during this course of this practice or qualifying session. It's not really in the racetrack like it needs to be. He's having to stay up on the wheel and keep working to try to hold the car where he wants to be. Now, look, entering turn three, it looks a lot better. Inside, you can still see him working very hard to keep the car where he wants it.
Now, he's had a fair amount of success here. He has four Homestead top 10 finishes. Now, he picks it up a little bit, but stays in the third position to a 31.64. That may be a lap that's good enough to possibly get him in this show.
I think that's right about where the brake line is going to wind up being.
Joe Nemechek still the fastest of the drivers who have qualified here. Long way to go, though. Bushball qualifying continues from the Homestead Miami Speedway here on Speed. Back at Homestead, Travis Kittleson, the slowest of five drivers to qualify here. Joe Nemechek is the fastest. 53 teams here to try to make this race. Carl Edwards in the number 60 cars had a tremendous season in the Busch Series and the Nextel Cup Series. See, he's knocked off four Busch poles.
But he has had an eventful couple of days here. This is a backup car. He crashed in yesterday's first practice, Jeff. These guys, they use brake coolers, not necessarily to cool the brakes as much as to try to keep the front tires cool, and one of the brake hoses rubbed a hole in one of the tires, and he crashed.
And, you know, when you do something like that right there, the crew chief always goes back and says, you know, how did we miss that, guys? I know that Brad Parrott was not very happy about that because he felt like that was the hot rod that was going to be able to get him to victory lane. But we're pretty confident that they can make some adjustments here. And I would say they made the right adjustments right now. He goes to the top of a leaderboard. And I believe last weekend, Brad Parrott was pretty emphatic about the fact that, hey, just got to believe me. Believe me, man. I told you could do it.
And what else did he say? Come get you some of that.
That's right.
And I think he will be one of the cars that will be one and done with this backup car. That is a good lap. He picked up 6/10 from what he ran in practice.
So Edwards trying to pick up his fifth pole, scored earlier at Las Vegas, Atlanta, Kentucky, and Phoenix. Bob Dillner.
There are plenty of double dippers here at Homestead, but Mark Martin, he's a triple dipper. He ran the Truck Series race this morning and finished in the top 10. But Mark, how about your Busch Series effort? How good is it going to be in qualifying here today?
I think it'll be pretty good. Our Pennzoil Ford was really great yesterday. We didn't practice a whole lot. We'll just see, you know, with this impound, we qualify, we run what we run, you know, and we're set up for the race.
Mark Martin had a lot of fun, guys, in the Truck Series race this morning. One thing he told me, he said, you know what? The track didn't change as much as I thought it was going to during that Truck Series race, so it didn't get as slippery as he thought.
Whoa, Denny Hamlin in the 20 car has crashed hard down in turn one and two. And he just had taken the green flag. And I believe these boys will, they'll be going to a backup car with this 20.
And that's going to be a pretty tall order in a short period of time for those guys, Larry McReynolds.
A lot of damage to the rear of that Chevrolet. Let's take another look at what happened to Denny Hamlin.
Took the green flag, drives off into turn one. See, the car just looked like it walked up the racetrack, got loose with him, and hard into the outside wall. And Denny Hamlin, he comes in here fifth in the Busch Series points.
Jeff, what about his line going in there?
It didn't look like it was that bad to me, Larry. I mean, Steve, but he's got in there, and it looked like, say, the back end started to come around. He tried to catch it, and it just got away from him, and up the outside wall he went.
Denny Hamlin to the garage. Carl Edwards is the fastest here at Homestead. More qualifying headed your way. Denny Hamlin has 18 top 10 starts this season, but he will not have one here today. Let's take a look what happened to him just moments ago.
Down in a turn right there, and you notice he may have gotten down on where the sixth degree of banking actually still was, Larry, and may have unloaded the car a little bit and basically made it loose.
Well, you get a feeling he was probably a little on the free side anyhow, and it didn't take much for that car to come around.
Clay Rogers from Mooresville, North Carolina, in the number 58 car.
And this is the car that Regan Smith has been driving a lot the second half of the season. But Regan Smith has been signed to drive the 35 Renzi car for 2006. So they decided to put Clay Rogers in his first lap, 31.82. He was 12th quickest in practice yesterday. He picks it up quite a bit on lap two, the fifth quickest. Pretty solid lap for Clay Rogers.
And of just tie up that story. Jason Keller is moving from that 35 car to the one car, James Finch-owned team, so Regan Smith will replace Jason Keller.
Oh, the movement in the Busch Series is getting about as much as it is in the Nextel Cup garage.
Marty Snyder.
Well, meanwhile, atop the stack is Carl Edwards. And you said that first lap was about perfect, wasn't it?
That's as good as it could be. Brad and all the charter team, everybody did a great job with the backup car. I did not expect. We didn't make a bonsai run. And, man, I got out of the throttle. And I was like, I don't think I need to be this far off the throttle. So I put it right back down. The car was perfect. The second lap, it got tight. But, I mean, considering what happened to Denny there, I mean, this is a track where if it's loose, it's really tough. And I'm really, really proud of my guys.
Hey, Marty, I want you to ask Carl something. When they gave him the time from lap one, unlike Phoenix, did they tell him what second bracket it was this week?
Yeah, did they tell you the second bracket this week when they gave you the time, unlike they did at Phoenix?
Yeah, they told me. I didn't even give them time to tell me. I knew it was a pretty good lap. Jason Stockert has a problem with the radio. We got to work on this. He's going to be a crew chief someday, but he's going to have to get the radio right.
Know where the button is?
He knows where the button is, but it's like he's got marbles or something in his mouth. All I hear is, I can't tell what's going on, so he'll get it right.
That doesn't work when you crew chief guys go, whoa, to the driver. You need to talk clearly.
Well, that means we don't really want him to know what we're telling him. But just to follow up on that last week at Phoenix, when Carl qualified, he ran a 27.20, and they just told him a 20. He thought he ran a 28.20. It's like, I need to step it up on this second lap. He stepped it up to sit on the Busch pole.
As Larry Mack said, Brent Sherman has been piloting that number 10 car for PPC Racing. He's in the 15 this week, on his way to the 49 car next year in the Nextel Cup Series.
His first lap, seventh quickest at a 31.84. He picks it up about 3/10. That's a pretty solid lap for Brent up to the fourth position. It's a good lap.
It's a big step up for that young man going to the Nextel Cup Series, and we'll check in now with Bob Dillner.
Stacy Compton's been paying attention to these track conditions and what happened to Denny Hamlin. Stacy, how concerned are you?
Well, we was talking earlier. We had a yesterday morning first practice. We had a top 10 race car. Second practice, we were about a 35th place race car. Third practice, we're another top 10 race car. This place is worse than Charlotte used to be. I mean, the sun comes in, it gets tight. Sun comes out, it gets really, really loose. So we changed everything but the paint again on this Kingsford Ford. I think we got a good race car. you never know. I mean, I've never seen a track change as much as this one does. But, you know, the good side of it is you got three grooves to run. So if a track changes and you have to slide up the racetrack, not by choice, you got a little room.
Guys, a lot of people here on pit road really paying attention to these cars as they're heading down into turn one to see how they react.
And Bob, now they're all paying attention to young Bernie Lamar driving for Kevin Harvick Incorporated. He'll be in that car, understand, full-time for Kevin next year.
He was 26 quickest in practice yesterday. His time was a 31.65. We're starting to see a lot of these cars pick up from what they ran in the final practice yesterday.
Well, a lot of them know it's time to go, but with Bernie Lamar, I mean, he knows he's solidly in this race here, I think, this weekend. But, yeah, he comes back and posts a really solid first lap right there. Fourth quickest right now to 31.46. So, you know, nice and smooth right there up off of turn two. See if he can pick it up a little bit more on lap two.
And looking at the speeds of qualifying, Carl Edwards nearly a full mile per hour faster than Joe Nemechek.
Oh, that's a whale of a lap. And the other thing is he picked up over a half a second of what he practiced at yesterday. So, I mean, when he gets ready to qualify, he pretty much puts everything on kill.
Yeah, that lap by Carl Edwards, that's right there about what Martin Truex Jr. ran in the final practice last night. Now, Bernie Lamar actually slows down about a tenth. So, right now, he'll be fourth quickest in the 33.
And Jeff, what is it that Jack Roush calls Carl?
The real deal.
All right. We'll take a break for Busch Pole qualifying. 10 drivers have qualified here today. Kevin LePage getting ready. We'll be right back. Steve Grissom, the slowest of 11 drivers who have qualified today, with the exception of Denny Hamlin, who did not complete his qualifying lap. We'll hear from him in just a second. The all-time winningest driver in NASCAR Busch Series history is on the racetrack right now, and that would be Mark Martin in the number 9 car. Won earlier this season at California and Vegas and took the pole at Richmond.
Of course, next year, Mark will be back in the 6 Nextel Cup car full-time. He'll be competing in a few truck races and some Busch races, he was telling us last week on our trackside show, and doing the triple duty here this weekend, as we were talking to him a while ago.
Said he was so busy, he almost didn't want to think about it.
Oh, yeah. He has already been busy this morning. He told me earlier when we came out for the crash truck races, and this is almost too early, but he was so excited about it. And right now, he'll be pretty excited about his first lap is good enough for second quickest. And if he can pick it up a little bit, he might be able to challenge his teammate right there, Carl Edwards. And whenever you see Mark Martin qualifying up front in a race package like he's got in this number 9 car, watch out.
Well, and again, we talked about Michael Waltrip, 3 short practice sessions yesterday. Mark Martin's another one of those cars that elected not to run the final practice session, but he was second quickest in practice number 2 of the 31-22, so he has already bettered that. Now, he slows down just a little bit, but a pretty solid run on lap 1.
So Carl Edwards and Mark Martin, the only drivers to top 173 miles per hour. Marty Snyder with what I guess would be a disappointed Denny Hamlin.
Yeah, disappointed, but okay, and that's the most important thing. What happened that started that, Denny?
I was on straightaway when I got loose. Can't really figure out what's wrong with these things. Just been really struggling a whole bunch with them. But, you know, we got a good backup car, Rockwell Automation Chevrolet. We'll find a way to get us ourselves in top 15 by the end of the day for sure.
All right, and Denny said the wreck kind of surprised him a little bit. Started getting loose on the straightaway. That's very unusual. Carl Edwards, currently the fastest here at Homestead, Miami.
Earlier this morning, the defending NASCAR Busch Series champion, Martin Truex Jr., how's he get ready for qualifying? Gets his hook wet, that's how.
He looks very intense, very focused on this fishing tournament. See Johnny Marsh right there, owner of the Bass Pro Shop.
64-point lead for Martin Truex Jr. over Clint Bowyer, trying to become the first NASCAR Busch Series driver to win back-to-back titles since Dale Earnhardt Jr.
Imagine that, and I'll be wanting to bet you something right now, guys. Martin is probably very proud of the fact that he won that tournament. I mean, he's a fierce competitor.
Whoa, he's in trouble. We talked about this, Jeff.
Yeah, I know it. This is what you don't want to have happen right now. This is what he did not need to have happen to him today. This could be the beginning of the end. And I'm not trying to say they can't rebound from it, but this is exactly what Clint Bowyer was looking for.
Before we talk about the championship, Martin Truex Jr. says no saving that. Why is this happening? Why?
I think a lot of this comes with the way the sun is right now. Look, he's coming down in the corner again. Car's already loose, entering the turn right there.
It was almost exactly what Denny Hamlin was describing. He talked about it. He said his car was loose before he even turned down in the corner, and Martin Truex Jr., the 8 car, looked the same way.
Well, that thing's just cocked sideways going in there, and he never gets it saved.
Never gets it saved, and guys, I'm going to tell you, from the truck race, this is what we kept hearing on the radio. The racetrack had no grip. You had to keep tightening the car up rather than loosening it up. So I think this is what's going on. A lot of guys have tried to set their car up for a long run in this race, which normally it gets tighter, but right now it's biting.
Well, I've got to believe they're probably going to go to a backup car because they're going to start at the rear of the field anyhow. Why not? So they're going to have to start this race later on this evening. You can see them unloading a backup car now with a car that has not been on the racetrack. If I'm Clint Bowyer and Gil Martin, I just want to go out with that 2 car and get a solid qualifying lap. I don't want to end up like this 8 car. Get a solid lap in, run 1 lap, and stop, because I'm starting the race already in front of this 8 car, which is where I need to be.
And you're starting it with a car that you know it should be able to work around a lot easier than what these guys are going to be able to do. So, yeah, you're exactly right, Larry. Now it's kind of like, if you're looking at momentum swings, it is now swung over to the Richard Childress camp and that 2 car.
And just remember, the points lead is only 64 points.
Now you see right there, there's Richie Gilmore, Steve Meehl. You're seeing the whole DEI contingent basically coming together here right now, trying to rally around this 8 car so they can get it ready to go in. Like I say, in just about 4 hours, they're going to get ready to start this race.
Clint Bowyer was looking on, and Martin Truex Jr. looks at his car and scratches his head. Let's go to Marty.
And Martin Truex Jr. talking it over with Richie Gilmore and Steve Mill, the technical director for DEI, and trying to describe what happened. He said there was no saving it. What happened, Martin?
Just spun out. You know, I was ready for it to be loose. It was loose down there, and I just went into one, and it just came around. I chased it all the way till it hit the fence. There wasn't no bringing it back. So
then he said the same thing almost with his wreck, that it was almost spinning out on the straightaway.
Yeah, I mean, as soon as I started letting out of the gas, I just chased it, and it just never gripped till I hit the wall. So we got a good backup car. We'll be fine.
It'll definitely be a backup car for these guys. They had talked about trying to salvage this one. Kevin Mannion just told the guys, let's start getting the backup ready.
But that just goes to show you how treacherous this racetrack is and how line sensitive. That's 2 of our top 5 that has crashed in qualifying.
And we go back to last night in final practice. Our Nextel Cup point leader, Tony Stewart, coming off turn 2, spins it around.
And we talked about how this track really is. I mean, this is what happens, whether it's daylight or night. It's very tricky. I mean, everybody thinks about, hey, the progressive banking allows you to have a lot of racing lanes. It does, but still, you have to have your car balanced and you got to have it gripping no matter what the situation is, because you're hauling the mail around this racetrack.
Well, I think the word's traveling fast, because now we're starting to see drivers take 1 lap and be done with it. As Justin Labonte ends up 10th quickest at a 31.87 in his last ride in this 44 car.
And Larry, need to mention too, Chris Wimmer made a qualifying attempt while we were in break, and he hit the wall. Wimmer 13th. Let's go back to Marty.
Hey guys, just pulling the backup car out for Martin Truex Jr. Now this is one of the neat things about NASCAR. You'll see the discount tire guys helping as well. Brian Patty ran over to Kevin Mannion and said, hey, we'll help you guys out, whatever you need. They're coming to help him get the car off, help him get it ready. This is the car Martin ran last week at Phoenix. Ran in top 10 for most of the day. Also some crew members from Kevin Harvick's team coming over just to help out, trying to get these guys ready for the race, which, as we said, happens in just a couple of hours.
But we've been seeing this for years in NASCAR. Even though you're down there trying your best to outrun each other every weekend to win a race, to win a championship, people don't want to beat you because you've had bad luck. They want to beat you on the racetrack, and we've seen this time and time again, not only in the Nextel Cup garage, but in the Busch garage.
The Busch garage also. I mean, again, NASCAR has always been this type of a sport. You may be having to fight the guy out there on that racetrack, but when you need some help, everybody pitches in.
But Jeff, Larry, let's talk about the preparation for that backup as we watch Stacy Compton. I'm guessing that car had shocks, springs, whatever you need underneath that car to be ready for this racetrack.
Well, I'm sure they had the car 100% race ready. But now what Kevin Mannion,
got
Martin
trouble
Truex
over here coming off of turn four right now. He gets loose right in the middle of three and four. Stacy Compton. Sorry about that. But all of a sudden he went up the racetrack and he did a good job of hanging on to the 59 car.
But he had a pretty good first lap at 31:55. But just going back to the 8 car, Steve, what they'll need to do now. That seems to be the word of
the
afternoon.
Larry, you can be excited and a little bit happy about it when you make a save like that.
Absolutely, especially when it came on lap two. But, Steve, what they'll have to do is make decisions based on everything they've learned throughout these 2 days, through the practice sessions last night. And they did test down here, but I've got a feeling, even though there was a lot of teams that tested here, this racetrack is totally different from the conditions they tested.
It have to be, Larry. I mean, because we've always seen it from time to time. When you come down here and you start putting rubber on the racetrack, the conditions, the heat, I mean, all these things come into play. It's going to be different. And right now, we're seeing it come out in a big way.
Bob Dillner standing by with the driver of JR Motorsports, as in Dale Earnhardt Jr. Bob.
That's right, Mark McFarland, and he is in the same family as Martin Truex Jr., so see what's going on out here, Mark, not to put any pressure on you, but to get you any more nervous?
It definitely makes you think about what you got, but this Navy Chevrolet has been good ever since we showed up here, so we're looking forward to this. I'm glad we got the season for next year started this early. Gives us a chance to think about things over the winter and get things really right. Just got to think Dale Jr. and his whole family and Junior Motorsports for this opportunity.
Hey, boys, it's pretty interesting with Mark McFarland here. Junior Motorsports, but what this car is actually a DEI car with an RCR motor, and Ken Schrader's crew is actually with them this weekend.
That's an all-star team, Bob.
Absolutely. They did whatever they had to do to get here. And I'm going to tell you what, Anthony Foyt in his 38 car, he had a close call off turn four on lap one. But still, even with that happening, 31:33, fourth quickest, and he's going after lap two.
Well, he looks a lot more under control than he did on that first lap. He definitely used up every inch of this racetrack on that first lap, Larry. He slows down just a little bit, but he's still good enough for fourth.
Carl Edwards still the quickest here, the time of 31.082, speed 173.734 miles per hour. More Busch Bowl qualifying right after this. Back at Homestead Miami Speedway, trouble for the driver of the 86 car, Mark Mitchell. Let's see what happened.
Now this, Jeff, is the opposite end of the racetrack, but it just came around with him probably about the time he picked the throttle up hard into the outside wall and turn forward.
And Larry, he was coming to the green, so he's trying to get all that momentum, but you can see inside there, watch his hands, and all of a sudden it just snaps around and he tries to catch it, but he does not do a good job. Up the outside wall he goes, hits hard in that safer barriers. But guys, we started practice early on. Track temperature was 93 degrees. It's already up to 98 degrees. So let's listen and hear what it sounds like when you spin out.
That's not a good sound to anyone, especially though to a driver that had to qualify on time. So this will be a car that does not make the show.
Let's go to Bob Dillner.
Matt Kenseth getting ready to go out in his waste management car. This track is really getting slippery, Matt. How about it here today?
I don't know. I don't think we have a real great car today, honestly. I think if we get qualified, we'll run okay in the race. But it's our last ride for waste management cars, so it's a tough weekend losing Johnny R today. 17 car. Every time I see that, I definitely think of him and Robbie. And I wouldn't be standing here today without the opportunities that they gave us. So I'm just thinking and praying about his family today. And it's a tough weekend.
Heavy hearts for everybody in this Busch Series garage area, Marty.
Well, Bob, Anthony Foyt had his hands full, too. That looked like an interesting qualifying lap.
Yeah, the a lot better qualifying. We had a slower lap in a mock qualifying run yesterday than we did in 50-lap tires, so we made a lot of adjustments, and the guys got the car pretty good for me. It is like a little bit loose, but you need it a little bit loose in qualifying.
So
you
can, a lot loose.
Yeah, so you can drive it like that. So that was the quickest lap we ran this weekend, so I'm happy with it. These guys worked hard for me, great clips here, and so they've been working hard, and I finally gave him a good qualifying run.
And as he said, fairly confident about the car and race trim as well, Steve.
And I want to give him a little bit of an attaboy because we looked a lot more well-groomed this week than we did last week.
It's his sponsor, Larry.
Considering our sponsor is Great Clips.
Yeah.
Looks a lot better this week.
I ain't going to go there.
You scared?
Well, I'm just going to say, I mean, the boy's got enough hair where he needs to get clipped every now and then. It looks good.
I would love to be able to go there more often, but I don't need to.
A little fishing in the infield here at the Homestead Miami Speedway. Denny Hamlin, Martin Truex Jr., Mark Mitchell have all hit the wall. Chris Wimmer hit the wall in turn four on his qualifying attempt, but he was able to finish his lap. Carl Edwards still the fastest. He and Mark Martin, the only two drivers over 173 miles per hour.
Well, I don't know about the Busch series, but here's a guy that should know what this racetrack's like. Todd O'Dwyer, who just once again earlier this morning in the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series race, just spanked them from start to finish. Three consecutive wins.
We're going to find out right quick if he was able to transfer some of that information over this 34 car. He's only 44th fastest in practice yesterday during happy hour. So let's see if he can tighten this thing up a little bit, this Dollar General car, and make some moves as far as up in his field for today's race.
We're not sure exactly what Todd will be doing next year as far as the Busch Series or this race team. We know that this sponsor has moved camp over to Kevin Harvick Incorporated for next year.
Bodine, a 15-time winner in the NASCAR Busch Series. Randy LaJoie has also spent time in the cockpit of that race car this year.
He's a triple dipper this weekend, too. Ran the Craftsman Truck Series race. He gets loose right there in the middle of one and two, chases it up the racetrack on his second lap.
And I think Todd knows that this car is locked into the show. I think he has seen what has unfolded in this qualifying session. He's just trying to get a couple of laps in. First lap, 32.08. 14th quickest out of the 16 cars that have completed qualifying.
And Todd has started all but one of the 11 Busch Series races here at Homestead.
And I know as I talked to his crew this morning, I know one thing they've been fighting regardless of the track temperature, just what we've seen with Denny Hamlin, with Martin Truex Jr., loose getting in the corner. When you're loose getting in the corner, there's nothing you can do about the rest of the corner.
Actually, today will be the 11th Busch Series race at the Homestead Miami Speedway. Let's go to Bob Dillner.
Here with Ryan Moore, and he's one of the DEI guys here among the DEI family and looking to make this Busch Series race. But any butterflies going out there for qualifying, Ryan?
Yeah, a little bit, but we're going to be all right. We ran last night something that happy at 45 minutes, and car's pretty good. We got it driving pretty good. So track's pretty hot right now compared to last night, and there's a lot of cars getting loose and getting into the wall. So got to kind of keep it, you know, be easy and keep it straight, but at the same time, we're going to have to go after pretty hard and get a good qualifying result and try to grab someone's eye so we can get something going on for next year. But still trying to get some sponsors together for DEI and get it to the point where we can do this every week. So just thank Kraft and everyone for helping us out this weekend and get a good lap in and go up to their skybox and have some fun with them.
Reach down in that pocket and show the boys in the booth. He's got a little luck on his side and found a lucky penny, or at least he hopes it's lucky here today at Homestead.
Well, Bob, Ryan Moore, he's one of those drivers that he's in a box. He's got to go out and qualify on time. He knows how bad this racetrack is right now, and he crashed in practice yesterday. So you talking about pressure on a young man, that's what I'd call pressure.
He might be wanting to look for a few more of those lucky pennies.
Kevin LePage won here in 1996. Larry Mack said at the top of the show, this track has been reconfigured. LePage, his first Busch Series victory on this racetrack.
And Larry, from what we've seen so far, we thought, you know, that like a 31.65 or 31.60 would be pretty solid. But right now, 31.73 by Kevin LePage, that might be okay after all, my friend, because the way the track is heating up.
Well, the way it's going, just complete lap one, and you may be in pretty good shape.
Slows down just a little bit on lap two, but he does run about 2.5 tenths quicker than what he practiced at yesterday. So we'll have to see how that kind of works out. But he's 11th quickest right now.
Our points leader, Martin Truex Jr., has crashed. He'll go to a backup car. Carl Edwards is the fastest here in Homestead. Mexico City's Carlos Contreras in the number 40 car of Fitz Bradshaw Racing. 11th fastest in his qualifying attempt. That car is guaranteed a starting spot. Let's go to Bob Dillner.
Brian Vickers in the Busch Series, as you guys mentioned earlier in this show, and he's been pretty happy with his race car, but is it good enough for the pole here today?
Yeah, I mean, the Ride Extra Crispy Chevy is running awesome. We were real happy with the car. Dana Brax came down here and tested. Jim and all the guys did a good job, Joe, engineer. So we're looking forward to the race. For us, unfortunately, my past team revision doesn't count. Since we didn't know that rule, I would have started a race last year. But hopefully we can get this car in the show. And I want to just say we're thinking of the Riser family. Just our hearts be out with them and thinking of their loss.
See, boys, earlier in the show, you guys mentioned that, and you talked big or something.
Yeah, you have to compete in the year leading up to the year you're trying to qualify. And I'm going to tell you what, speaking of qualifying, Casey Kane, 31.03, to the top of the charts. And, Jeff, I watched it while we were interviewing Brian Vickers. Where a lot of that came was through 3 and 4 coming to take the green. We talk about that every week. If you're going to do it on lap one, coming to take the green.
You got to get your momentum up, and he's really giving us Lowry's number 6 a good ride. And I didn't realize what Lowry's was, but it's seasoning. I didn't realize what that company is. I don't do a lot of cook.
When you marinate your steaks, come on, Ammon.
I know.
We know he doesn't because he doesn't give us the Johnsonville brats on trackside.
That's right.
He doesn't cook.
Does not help us out whatsoever. But I'm going to tell you where else this lap could have came from besides getting through turn 3 and 4, starting to see a little bit of clouds rolling here. My good buddy DW next door shared that with me.
Darrell Waltrip is observing qualifying next to us and harassing us somewhat.
He's doing a lot of figuring over there. I'm not sure exactly what it is.
Well, what's Bobby D got going on down there today? Bobby?
I'm talking to John Wood here because he was second quick in that final practice session yesterday, and he was just watching Casey Kane put up that lap. Can you beat that?
That's fast. I don't know. We've been qualifying very well lately, and it's probably not out of the possibility, but we need to be a little bit better than where we are right now. I think that we can have a decent top 5 starting spot.
You like these clouds, though, don't you?
Do what?
You like these clouds, though, don't you?
I do. I mean, I wish it would get dark. we were really good last night when it was cool, and I think that we have a good race package for this afternoon when it gets a little cooler.
And John Wood going to do 7 cup races next year and go full-time.
All right, thank you, Bob. Jerry Robertson from Arvada, Colorado on the racetrack.
He was pretty solid in practice last night, 22nd quickest, qualified for his very first Nextel Cup race last week in Phoenix. 31.63 puts him 10th quickest out of the 20 cars that have completed, but gets loose, get into turn one.
We got the fence,
now, here's a scenario. He will have to go to a backup car. He is a go-or-go-home car, but I think that first lap will get him into the show. But this car definitely will not be able to race later on today. They'll have to go to a backup car.
Take another look at the misfortune of Jerry Robertson.
Drives it off into turn one. He was almost loose, about like Martin Truex described. The minute he rolled out of the throttle, the car got loose with him. And you know, Jeff, we don't need to be up here being armchair crew chiefs, but these guys that are go or go home cars, why would you run this second lap when you're in the show?
Larry, I'm sitting here shaking my head right now thinking the same thing. It's like, man, he just laid down an awesome lap. And I was going to say Jerry has been able to do that many, many times this year. He's done an excellent job as far as making his way into these races. And to have that happen to him on the second lap is pretty sad right there. So hopefully they can get the backup car ready and he'll be able to make the race today.
Jeff, this has been a great racetrack for Casey Kane. He's won here in the Busch Series, the Truck Series, and right now he's our pole sitter.
A lot of success here at Homestead Miami, and fast lap. He said a little bit loose, though.
Yeah, I think everybody is. It's showing by some of the things that are going on here. But just the track's changed so much this weekend with the weather, you know, the weather changing and stuff. There's just not a lot of grip out there. But this Lowry's Dodge Charger was really good, and we're looking forward to the race. I think we got, you know, just as good of a car for a race. So we'll see if we can't get a good qualifying and then a good start in the race.
I mentioned Lowry's. Can you believe Jeff Hammond did not know what Lowry's was? Clearly the man has never grilled out, has he?
I can't believe that. That's some, I like the Lowry's seasoning salt the best. That's what I like the best, Jeff. But, yeah, they do a lot for grilling out. That's what it's all about.
Hammond, come on. You've grilled out, haven't you? Come on, man.
Yeah, but see, the thing is, guys, I'm a real man. I just throw the meat on there, and I just chew it. And I mean, I don't worry about it. I just work out like that. But now I know how to make it better.
Hammond, you know what? Hammond, he'll just throw meat on the grill. He doesn't have any vegetables with it. He just eats it right off the grill.
That's it, baby.
Sheep.
It doesn't matter. Don't matter.
We'll be right back.
About talent.
Betty is out in front. Betty wins it.
Sportsmanship.
Bobby Allison, Davey Allison is trying to second.
And fame. Only the best earn the title Speed Channel Driver of the Year. And this quarter's nominees are Dan Weldon, Sebastian Bourdais, Tony Stewart, Jimmy Johnson, Carl Edwards, Mark Martin, Tony Schumacher, and Steve Kenser. Log on to SpeedTV.com now and catch your vote for Driver of the Quarter.
And back at the Homestead Miami Speedway, Jerry Robertson's race car towed back to the garage. It's been an eventful qualifying session, to say the least. Our points leader, Mark Truex Jr., backs it into the wall.
And this was right after taking the green flag. He'll have to go to a backup car.
Another look at him, coming in here with a 64-point lead over Clint Bowyer.
As he said, the car just didn't have any grip at all entering turn one. You see him unloading the backup car, trying to get it ready for the race that's going to be coming up here in about 4 more hours.
And we're not quite halfway through this qualifying session.
There are a list of the drivers that have had trouble today.
And you know what I say, he wasn't by himself.
But I hate that for Jerry Robertson, because we talked about it before we went to break. He's 10th quickest right now. He had a good solid lap in. Now he'll have to go to a backup car and go to the rear of the field.
Chris Wimmer able to complete his qualifying lap. We go to Bob Dillner.
Jamie McMurray in a different ride again this week in the Busch Series, the James Finch-owned car. He was just speaking to Mark Reno, and Jamie just asked me before we came to him, why is everybody wrecking? Well, let's find out how Jamie McMurray's car is going to do out here on this slippery racetrack. How about it, Jamie?
Well, it wasn't real fast in race trim. The car was just kind of numb. It seemed like we started with one setup, and Johnny's car was pretty good, so I told him at the break, I said, just put in what he has, shocks, springs, everything, and went out, and it drove pretty much the same way. So it drives good. It just doesn't seem to have a lot of speed in it. And we made our qualifying run at the end of the day, and I was pretty loose, so seeing all these guys be loose is a little bit scary, but we've made some adjustments, whether it was with air pressure, the track bar. We've done a few things, so hopefully we've got it tight enough. I was just asking Mark, a lot of the guys are wrecked in front of me. Guys have to qualify on time, and I told him, I said, we need to figure out if enough guys are wrecked that we just have to run a lap to get in so that we don't, you know, tear our stuff up.
I want to know, what does numb mean, or what does a numb feel car feel like?
It just doesn't seem to respond. I mean, you take spring out of the left rear, put it in the right rear, change the front springs, the car just it has the same characteristics every time you pull out. So just numb, there's no feeling.
Crew chief, you ever have a driver tell you your car felt numb?
I'm glad you asked it, because I really wanted to know that one. I never heard that one, but now I know.
Jason Leffler in the 32 car.
Pretty good first lap, 31:53. That puts him ninth quickest. He was 13th yesterday. It's about the same time he ran yesterday. He ran a 31:52.
And here we go again, Larry McReynolds. Why run two? You're in the race. You put in a pretty good lap right there. Why do you want to roll the dice?
We'll see. Pretty much like we've been seeing consistently, he slows down about a tenth on lap two. And I know this team, Jason Leffler, working diligently trying to put a package together for 2006. They've been so solid with this team since Jason Leffler took it over several races ago.
Leffler, of course, started the season with Joe Gibbs Racing, driving the number 11 car. The FedEx car was released. Denny Hamlin took over that ride after Terry Labonte gave it a few starts. And now the number 88, Mark McFarland, driving for JR Motorsports, a team owned outright by Dale Earnhardt Jr.
Well, we talked to Mark McFarland earlier, who is a past NASCAR champion. They plan on running the full schedule in 2006. Now, this team has no affiliation with Chance 2 Motorsport that owns Martin Truex Jr.'s car, RDEI. As you heard our guys a while ago say, they're running Richard Childress Racing engines. But what Dale Earnhardt Jr., I talked to some of his people this morning. He's trying to create a huge driver development program. He also owns a Hooters Pro Cup car that Shane Huffman drives. What he'd like to do is midway through this coming season is put Shane Huffman in a Busch Series ride and maybe move someone from late model up to that Hooters Pro Cup. And I hear that Dale Earnhardt Jr. is involved with this race team on a day-to-day basis. He loves being an owner of what has going on here.
Remember, he told us on
the
track side.
He's going to love this right now, too, guys. That car right there is now qualified seventh. He is safely in the show. Got a pretty heavy left front fender rub right there, Larry. So, I mean, it's like, crew chief, hello. Somebody tell him to back off and come on in.
But he's going to go ahead and try to complete this lap two. And as you say, he's seventh quickest on lap one.
And Larry, Jeff, remember on track side back at Kansas, Dale Earnhardt Jr. said how excited he was but nervous about this race team.
Well, remember, those first five races next year, they've got to qualify on time. They are not locked into the show, just as they are not locked into this show. But that right there, that'll let him race.
Mark McFarland, seventh quickest. Casey Kane is our provisional pole sitter. We're about halfway through Busch pole qualifying, and there's Jason Leffler. We'll be right back. One and done for Curtis Davis, and nicely done. A top 10 qualifying run for Curtis Davis. He is ninth.
That's the way it's supposed to work. It's a car that had to qualify on time. He gets a good first lap. He shuts it down.
He picks up 4/10 from practice. So good job there, young man.
Marty Snyder.
I asked Jason Leffler why he ran a second lap, because he thought it would be faster, but a nice solid lap got you in on lap one, Jason.
Yeah, it's, the Voxbox Infiniti mobile car is pretty good. Really good in race trim. And lately, we just haven't been qualifying well at all. Every time we tape up, we slow down. But in the race, the thing goes forward, and that's all you can ask for. You know, all the guys at Braun Racing doing a great job. And got a different paint job again this week. So everybody on TV, look for the number 32 Infiniti mobile car to get up front.
Bob?
David Stramey and I have been chatting about what he's not going to do in qualifying. And what is that, David?
Well, the main thing is keep it off the wall. It looks like everybody's having a hard time doing that today. I had my fun share last week. But, I was talking to John Weaver on my team, and he's got pretty heavy hearts here. And I didn't find out till this morning that John Reiser had passed away. And our thoughts and prayers go out to his family, because he was an enjoyable person to talk to in the garage. Very cheerful all the time, and we're going to miss him in our sport.
Those sentiments echoing through the garage area.
Thank you, Bob. Let's see if Clint Bowyer can capitalize on the misfortune that Martin Truex Jr. has experienced.
Now, he was 20th quickest in practice last night, and he comes in here 64 points behind Martin Truex Jr., but we know where Martin Truex Jr. is going to start this race, at the back of the field with that backup car.
And if there's one person on the racetrack right now that can feel the pain of Martin Truex, Clint Bowyer is the guy who can do it. He's had some problems in qualifying himself recently. His first lap, good enough for 16th at a 31.66. And Larry, he looks like he's kind of floating it down in that corner right now.
He knew he just needed to get a solid lap in. Right now, it looks like he's going to go ahead and go for this second lap, which, again, somewhat surprises me, because right now he's 16th with lap one.
And that's about what he ran yesterday in practice. A little bit high coming up off of turn four there. Gets it back down off the wall.
Picks it up 3/10 on lap two to sixth quickest. So we know, for the most part, I know we have a lot of cars to go. He will start this race when the green flag drops and they complete lap one. As the points will be then, he will be the points leader when this race starts.
McReynolds, I just figured this out. In our early part of our broadcast, you said, hey, all Clint Bowyer needs to start doing is throwing Hail Mary passes. This may have been the beginning of the first round of throwing that kind of pass, because he says, if I go up toward the front and lead early, well, now I put more pressure on the guy that I'm chasing.
And you talked about little bites, that Clint Bowyer was taking little bites. Well, that racetrack took a big bite out of Martin Truex Jr.
It will start as a big bite, absolutely.
And again, you've heard several drivers today comment about the passing of John Reiser. Robbie Reiser is Matt Kenseth's crew chief in the Nextel Cup Series, and Matt Kenseth is on the racetrack, no doubt racing with a heavy heart today.
You heard him in his interview. He's not been that happy with this race car since they unloaded it. This is the same car that he won with at Darlington back in the spring, but I talked to Chad Norris, the crew chief, this morning, pretty much said the same thing. We just can't get the car to react, but I'll just bet you when they drop the green flag tonight, regardless of where he qualifies, he will probably be a factor.
Larry, he has five finishes of eighth or better here in the Busch Series.
Finished third at Phoenix last week. Pretty solid lap. And he's already locked in the show, 10th quickest at a 31.51. He's locked in as well as Joe Nemechek and Mark McFarland.
He used quite a bit of racetrack right there from the middle of turn two, exiting down on the back straightaway. So let's see what he can do here on the second lap, because we've already seen where Clint Bowyer picked up 0.3 on his final lap. But he's rim riding right there off of turn four again. So let's see what he comes out to be as far as speed on the 17. Actually slows down about 0.2.
But he definitely picked it up a couple of tenths from what he ran in practice last night.
Marty Snyder with the driver chasing Martin Truex Jr.
And qualified six, solidly in the field. And did your mindset change at all when you saw what happened to Martin in terms of your qualifying lap, Clint?
Well, not just Martin, just everybody out there spinning out. Definitely scared of going all out for it. But, after the last 3 weeks, that's pretty good for us. So we'll take that. Ace-Idoco Chevrolet was pretty good in race trim, just like it has always been. And, just real optimistic still. They'll get him fixed up, and, he'll be right back up there. But, we just got to do what we do, Just go out there and run our hardest and hopefully try to win this thing.
Did that renew your enthusiasm about possibly winning this championship today? And you'll have a lot of track position to start the race off with versus the eight. So will that change what you do during the race?
Well, it definitely spices things up a little bit, huh?
All right, that's all he had to say. They talked a little bit about championship, but, he told me a moment ago, we're focused on winning the race, doing the best we can do. We can't worry about what the 18 does.
All right, thank you, Marty. And they don't give out an award for most improved driver, but if they did, this guy would get it. Paul Menard has 14 top 10 finishes in the second half of this season.
Yeah, he's moved up to seventh in points. He was pretty solid in practice. He was fifth quickest at a 31.25. Let's see what he can do. It's going to be a little slower, but eighth quickest right now is 31.45.
And, Jeff, you mentioned yesterday during cup practice that he's been practicing Robbie Gordon's cup car. Robbie's at the Baja 1000, and he was in the top 10 in one of the practices.
Yeah, he looked really good. He came actually and tested the 7 car for Robbie. Robbie knew he was not going to be able to make it today. And he told us, he said, if Paul does a good job, qualifies, I said, I might even let him race the thing, because Robbie knows he can't get up any higher in the owner points. And I did get a report from the Baja race that Robbie had broken the shock, was 45 minutes behind the leader, but he was charging it like always. He was trying to make up ground. And pretty good lap right there on the first lap for Paul Menard. Good enough for 8 quickest as far as his Busch effort here.
Hema's got people in Mexico?
I wouldn't doubt it. Not for a second. He has people everywhere.
Bob Dillner.
David Green, 35th quick in that final practice session. So, former champ, what are we going to expect from qualifying here today?
Well, I like the clouds coming in. I've been back here watching you guys on TV, and a lot of guys having problems. But right now it's pretty sunny. But, hey, I got my Borgette bike work sunglasses on. I'm usually not a sunglass guy, but had a ball with those guys last week. And, our Kleenex Happy Holidays scheme this weekend, maybe we can bring a good luck here at Homestead. But I got to say I'm proud of my whole Kleenex team. Bob, all year long for digging, never giving up, winning Pikes Peak, and having a lot of good runs. But this is a racetrack I really enjoy. What a great facility. It's a little bit slick right now, but we got a good race car. We can get a couple good laps of qualifying in.
Steve, he's starting to sound like Michael Waltrip.
He touched all the bases there, Bob. Aaron Fike in the 43 car.
Well, guys, you got to realize one thing. This is the last race, so you better get all you can get in while you can.
Aaron Fike is a go-or-go-home car. Pretty solid lap. 16th quickest for Aaron at a 31.61. That's a pickup of close to half a second from what he ran in practice last night.
Puts him in pretty good position right now, but I think we need to go back and just check. Note the fact that Mark Martin, Joe Nemechek, Mark McFarland, as well as Matt Kenseth, have all now been locked in after Aaron Fike making his run.
And we know that Chris Wimmer and Mark Mitchell, they will not make this show because already too many cars have beat those go-or-go-homers.
30 drivers have qualified thus far here for Busch Pole qualifying. 53 drivers are scheduled to make qualifying attempts here. Let's take a look at the action here on this tough Homestead Miami Speedway. Denny Hamlin in the 20 car backs it in.
Man comes in here fifth in the points. This is Chris Wimmer coming off turn four, and here's our points leader, Martin Truex Jr. Gets loose, turning off into turn one, hard in the outside wall. There you see him unloading a backup car.
Mark Mitchell in the 86.
And most recently, Jerry Robinson, who had already laid down a pretty good first lap. This was on lap two. He's in the show, but he'll have to go to a backup car.
Ryan Moore showed us his lucky penny, driving a DEI car, a Chevrolet.
And he was seventh quickest in practice yesterday afternoon, and I talked about him crashing in practice yesterday. They came down here and tested, and he was involved in a crash there as well. This is the same car that Martin Truex Jr. drove at Texas two or three weeks ago.
Made his Busch Series debut at Loudoun in July. The son of Kelly Moore, a longtime NASCAR Busch North Series competitor. Nice lap by Ryan Moore.
Good job, young man. Fourth quick right there.
Lucky penny worked. And Larry McReynolds talked about all the pressure. You said that he was in a box and he came through the clutch.
And the thing about it, I would have stopped him after lap one.
Larry's going to have a nervous breakdown.
I don't care if he picks up or not. I mean, right now he's fourth quickest with a car that's go or go home, where we've already seen five cars crashing qualifying.
Hammond, you're going to have to get some medicine for Larry Mack. I don't think he's going to make it through 53 cars.
Picked up a bad week to give up Prozac, I guess.
Marty Snyder.
I'm not on Prozac, just to let you know, and I'm not going to touch that one about Larry Mack. So, nice lap for you, Paul Menard. Have all those laps in the Cup car helped this Busch Series program this weekend?
Yeah, I mean, laps just help you learn, you know, and that's what I'm doing this weekend, is learn a lot on the Cup car. Jim Beam Chevy's pretty good on the Cup side. The Menard Chevy's pretty decent on the Busch side, so real loose, though, in qualifying. I mean, I was watching it on TV, all the cars wrecking, and just took a real conservative lap. Real free getting into the center, and pick up the gas, and it drove really good off. So we lost our time getting in, but really good on long runs, race runs, and looking forward to it tonight.
Bob?
Johnny Sauter finished 21st in the Truck Series race this morning at Homestead, and I know he's hoping to do a lot better here in qualifying in the race today for the Busch Series.
Obviously. Struggled a little bit in the truck this morning, and it was a late night last night, and had a tough time getting up this morning, Bob. So just... Mikosuke Dodge has been really good. Busch car's been really fast. It's my favorite car that we've got. So we never made a qualifying run yesterday, and we were really fast last night. It was really comfortable, and I see a lot of guys spinning out, so hopefully we don't have that problem. But nonetheless, I look for a good day.
Here's a scoop on the number one car, Larry Mack. I know you wanted to know this. They were just a little too heavy on the left side weight coming through tech, so they had to add some right side to make this car pass.
Yeah, how NASCAR weighs these cars is they weigh the total. They have to weigh 3,400 pounds total on the four scale pads. But then you have to weigh 1,600 pounds minimum on the right side. And I watched some cars going through earlier before I came to the booth. I mean, NASCAR was making them go after that 1,600. I saw a couple of cars that was 1,597, 3 pounds light. They were making them put weight in those race cars, and they should be consistent.
Speaking about being consistent right now, Brian Vickers in that 57 car laid down a really good first lap. He picks it up just a little bit on his second lap. He's now up, moved from ninth up to sixth quickest. So a good qualifying effort right there by him.
And Jeff, one note on Paul Menard, just to tie that up. I mentioned he had 14 top 10 finishes. Didn't have a single one the first 15 races of this year.
No, we've been watching his progress, and I think you pretty much pointed it out. If there was some award for the most improved, that whole team right there, they finally, like, got it together, and he just keeps putting solid run after solid run week in and week out together. So, I mean, they are going to be a force to reckon with come 2006.
Well, Jeff, coming up next on Speed, the hunt is down to the final race. Tony Stewart is chasing his second championship. Everyone else is chasing Tony. Can anyone catch smoke? Football qualifying live at Homestead, Miami, right here, next on Speed.
Okay, let me set the stage for that. Those guys have not been on the racetrack since last night. The track continues to get hotter. They have a shorter rear spoiler on the back of the car.
Whew, and more horsepower.
Yeah.
So okay. It's like this right here. You add this with that. To me, that equation right there don't add up. And somebody's probably not going to be real happy with this racetrack when it comes time for qualifying. And all the guys that are doing the double dipping, I can bet you they've been back over in that garage area saying, you better do something before we have to go out there and qualify that car.
Well, I know who just did something here on this qualifying lap. John Wood, who was second quickest in practice last night. Third quickest in this 47 car.
And he needs just a tenth, Larry, and he could be on the pole.
and he's got some overcast skies.
And he's going after this second lap. This is a car that's locked into the show. He ran a 31-14 last night, so he's already improved that by a little bit.
His best start this year is second. He has yet to score a NASCAR Busch Series pole. Will he do it?
He picks it up a little bit, just not enough. 31-09. So right now, John Wood in the 47 car will be third quickest.
Casey Kane is the quickest, followed by Carl Edwards and now John Wood. And we go to Bob Dillner.
Well, Steve, do you think this guy can get the pole?
Yeah.
Yeah, Ryan Newman, always fast no matter where he goes. 5 wins in the Busch Circuit this year. But is this car capable of sitting on the pole here today? We know you are.
I know the car is. I just hope I am. It's a good all-tail Dodge for sure. It's the same car we've had at some of the races this year, and really fast yesterday in practices, and look forward to the opportunity.
Ryan Newman going for another pole here in the Busch Series this year, and he's been talking to Billy Weiss, that new driver development dude for Penske Racing.
And Bob, Ryan Newman has 3 poles in the Busch Series this year. Chicagoland, the second Dover race, and most recently at Texas.
Here's Jamie McMurray in that second James Finch car, the 09 car. And this is a go-or-go-home car. Yesterday, he was 15th quickest.
Now, you heard him say earlier, guys, just how good a lap do I need to run? I don't want to wreck this thing. Have enough guys had problems to where I can just put down a lap and make this race? And right now, he's using up a lot of racetrack, Larry.
Well, he ran a 31.53. If he can just better that by just a little bit, he'll be in this show. But he is not there yet, 31.68. So he needs to actually pick it up a little bit. That's going to be very borderline.
His car is numb.
Still numb.
Numb.
No response.
No response.
It's not listening to us, what he needs to run.
That's what my wife says to me. Listen, no response. No.
Selective here.
That's it.
So Jamie needs to pick it up about a tenth and a half if he definitely wants to race later on this evening here in his 300-miler. Let's see what he can do. He actually slows down just a little bit.
That is
so
not what he wanted to do right
there. Very borderline. But that will lock Brent Sherman in the 15 car into the show for tonight.
McMurray finished second here in the Busch Series race a year ago. Now fighting to make the show. More Busch Pole qualifying straight ahead. Down 35 drivers have clocked in here at Homestead, Miami for Busch Pole qualifying. Kevin Hamlin currently 19th. Casey Kane is the quickest. Bob Dillner.
Kenny Wallace doing some calisthenics here, getting ready to go in the car. He's one of the double dippers this weekend, also in the 97 Cup Series car. But how was this car? Because you didn't look too fast yesterday in practice.
You know what? This is a really good car. You guys were commenting in the booth that Matt Kenseth had the car that he won Darlington. Well, this is the car that ran second at Darlington, so I feel good about it. You know, we've been going through a lot of changes here, and the guys in the booth, y'all got it right, because when we came down and tested, everybody was fighting tight. Now all of a sudden, sometime yesterday evening, the track went dead loose on everybody. So, you know, this South Florida will throw a lot of spins at you, I guess. So we'll just see what we got.
Marty?
Well, Bob, real quick, just to update everyone on Martin Truex Jr.'s car and where they stand with it. You see Kevin Manning could bring you a couple springs out here. Just talked to Kevin, the crew chief. He said, you know, we're about 50% done with where we need to be. They have, as I count, 22 people in and out of this car working on it right now. They do have some more work to go. Just confirming what Larry Mack said earlier, it did have a race set up for Homestead already in it. He said they had a couple of things to tweak on that, but really they were pretty close to where they came here and started practice yesterday. So actually on Thursday. So the car is about 50% done, and they'll have it ready certainly in time for the race and inspection this afternoon.
Thanks, Marty. Great report. Jeff, I saw you looking at your watch. They're okay time-wise as far as preparation.
No, if they're 50% done right now, as we take a look at David Stremme, who just qualified 13th, yeah, I think if you got 20 people, they're putting a full-court press on it. The main thing is, once you get all that stuff done, if I'm the crew chief on a car, I want to say timeout. I want to go back through that car myself. I'm going to put my hands on a lot of things, and I'm going to double-check with my key personnel to make sure that whatever I might have missed, that they didn't. Because, again, this is one of those times, don't beat yourself with a loose oil line failure to make sure that the wheels are tight. Any of those little things, when you get in a rush like this, that you overlook.
Marty?
That's a great point by Jeff. And actually, Kevin Bono had brought that up to me. He said, you know, I've told everybody to hurry here, but I've also told them to take their time. You got to realize a season's worth of work is going into this race car right here trying to win a championship. So you can't throw it away by making a silly mistake a couple of hours before a race. So, yes, they are in a hurry to get this car ready, but they're also taking their time, making sure they do everything right.
And the one other thing I want to point out right now, don't ever say that racing is not a team sport. Look at this team rallying around everybody. I mean, all these guys right now are contributing as one. I mean, they're all working on one common, direction right now, and that is trying to get this car prepared to be able to go out and get their second championship in a row.
I even see some of the Budweiser, Dale Earnhardt Jr.'s Nextel Cup guys there. Remember, the Nextel Cup, it's an impound race. The 8 car is already on the line. For qualifying, there's no more work for them to do. I even see some of the Napa guys there. So, yeah, I mean, it looks like a joint effort by Dale Earnhardt Incorporated.
Yeah, great teamwork by DEI. Meanwhile, David Green, fourth fastest, 37 drivers taking time. We're scheduled to have 53 drivers qualify.
That's a huge pickup right there by David Green. Almost, what, 7/10 of a second on that first lap right there to put him up there in fourth position. And he said, hey, I've got a pretty good race car right here, and he just proved it.
And you know, the first time the Nextel Cup cars came here in 1999, the inaugural race, you know who the Bud pole sitter was? David Green.
In the Pennzoil car, wasn't it?
No, it was actually, that was in the Tyler Jett car.
Tyler Jett car.
That's right.
Chad Knaus was involved with that car. I think that was one of the first times at a mile-and-a-half racetrack that someone took advantage of soft front springs, really got the car down on the ground, got the rear up. That's when it really first started coming about there, was about 1999.
So David Green, fourth fastest. Ahead of him, Casey Kane, Carl Edwards, and John Wood.
Looking at the 64 car right now, this week being driven by Mike Wallace, owned by Rusty Wallace.
This is Mike's second turn behind the wheel of this number 64 car. For the Busch Series this year, he's driven the 6 for Ray Evernham, the 09 for James Finch, and a 6 races behind the wheel of the 38 car.
Oh, he gets down in the middle of the corner right there, and that car goes a D-I-D-O right there. He has to chase it up the racetrack. Got a little bit loose right in the center.
And he was 23rd quickest in practice at a 31.63. He's not quite back to that at a 31.74. This car, by virtue of owner points, it is locked into the show, but he has slowed down from what he ran in practice.
Slight difference in Busch pole qualifying. The top 30 in car owner points are guaranteed a starting spot versus 35 in the Nextel Cup Series.
And you know, I talked to Joe Ballas, Busch Series director, this morning. We were talking about 2006, and for the most part, there's not a lot going to change for the Busch Series next year. All of their races will be the impound race. They're going to be tightening up some of their aero templates, so there's some of the body templates. They are up in the right side weight. We were talking about Johnny Sauter's car. They're going to up it to 16.25, but for the most part, these guys are not going to have any rule changes from 2005 to 2006.
Bob Dillner is standing by with the Biff.
That's right, and this should be right up Greg Biffle's alley. You know, a nice, slippery racetrack. He could put the foot to the floor. So we going to see you on the pole here today?
I don't know. It's those guys laid down some fast laps. I've seen a lot of guys spin out here, you know, so we want to be careful. We got the Royal Office car here. We want to try and get a good spot. But I didn't make a qualifying run, and we'll see where we end up.
New colors for Greg Biffle on the side of this race car here today.
Thank you, Bob.
And that man is 10th in Busch Series points, and he's ran 8 less races than everyone else up there. Carl Edwards actually did miss a race back in June at Nashville because of a rainout, but to be 10th in points, 8 less races, that's pretty phenomenal for a driver of the team.
And Larry, speaking of top 10, you see Jason Keller in the 35 car. He's trying to keep a streak alive. If he can stay in the top 10 after today's race, it'll be his 7th consecutive season in the top 10 in points.
Yeah, he's sitting 9th in points, and we were talking earlier, Jason Keller will be moving to the James Finch number 1 car that Johnny Sauter's in. Johnny Sauter's going to be moving to the 44 car, and then Regan Smith will be in this car right here. But Jason Keller, 270 consecutive starts, started back at Richmond in 1997. not a real good first lap for Jason. 32.04 right now. That puts him 33rd quickest.
Yeah, it's actually about 3/10 slower than he had practiced at. But like a lot of people right now, I'm sure Jason's just trying to be careful to make sure he brings that 35 car back around to complete these qualifying laps. I'm sure he'll pick it up some on the second lap, and he does.
He had a 31.78, and we talked about consecutive starts. He'll be making his 391st career start, 26 races to go before he catches the all-time leader of Tommy Houston at 417. So he should do that next season.
And he'll tie Elton Sawyer, who is second all-time in starts at Daytona in February. Bob?
J.J. Yaley talking to the crew here and trying to figure out what's going on with this racetrack and how slippery it is. But this should be right up your alley as well, because you used to slinging the car around sideways on those old dirt tracks back in the USAC days.
Yeah, unfortunately, there's no cushion to catch you once you get up there by the fence. But the Vigor Ultra Turf winterizer car has been real good. Just hope that we can keep this thing up front here qualifying. I know we got a really, really good race car. I learned some things yesterday in practice. Slowing down, going fast definitely applies to this racetrack. So we'll get this good race today. Hopefully we can break the top 10 points, go home, spread a little bigger on the grass, and get the grass looking green for next winter.
A little sentimental feel for J.J. Yaley here today, of course, because next year he goes to the Cup Series as a full-time cupper.
He replaces Bobby Labonte in that 18-car box. Of course, Bobby Labonte going to the 43-car at Petty Enterprises. Tim Sauter is in the 36-car this week. We've seen Stanton Barrett and T.J. Bell behind the wheel of that race car.
Yeah, this is a one-way race deal for Tim Sauter. Talked to Ricky Pearson this morning, crew chief for this team, as Tim's first lap is only 35th quickest, but this car is locked in, and he said they're working on a lot of different things and the different angles for 2006. They've even actually had some inquiries from some Nextel Cup guys about possibly doing a few races in this car. And I think a lot because of the testing rules, where you're going to be so limited on your testing in Nextel Cup and the Busch Series, they're locking you into the racetracks you can test at. I anticipate we'll see more and more Nextel Cup guys running some of the Busch Series races. I know they were originally talking about more impound races for Nextel Cup in 2006. I'm now hearing where that may get a lot less than it is this year.
Yeah, Mike Helton addressed that this weekend here at Homestead Miami Speedway.
More news to follow on that story.
Yeah, that's a fact.
Yeah, and as far as Tim Sauter is concerned, he didn't pick up on the second lap. As you see, he'll be right now, he's 35th as far as the starting grid. And have to wait and see the conclusion where he winds up, but he will be racing this afternoon.
Tim, the older brother of Johnny Sauter,
who happens to be on the racetrack at the moment.
Glad Johnny could wake up for qualifying.
Yeah, I mean, that's a lot of pressure put on the driver. Had to get out of bed and go do the job, you know what I'm saying? What do you do with these young guys, Larry McReynolds?
I have no idea.
You have that problem with your son, Brandon, getting him out of bed to go drive his race car?
Yes, absolutely.
Well, maybe he's meant to be a driver, right?
He's destined, exactly. Now, Johnny Sauter was 34th quickest in practice yesterday at a 31.80. Biggest thing this team has fought this year is DNFs. At one point, they were working hard on getting in the top 10 in points, but the 8 DNFs has pretty much been the Achilles heel for this race team this year.
I should cut Johnny some slack. He was actually telling Bob he had to wake up early for the truck race, which started at 8:30 this morning after being rained out last night.
I'm still not buying at 8:30 early.
Yeah, the thing is right now, he may be sitting right next door, but I'll tell you, it's the same thing with whether you're a young driver or a veteran driver like Darrell Walter. They hate getting up early in the morning. They just hate it.
He hates getting up early as a broadcaster now.
I didn't bring that up.
Well, I did.
Oh, hang on to her, Johnny. He does basically that little what you call death wobble right in the middle of 3 and 4 and does a good job of keeping it off the wall.
How is the death wobble different than the D-Dido?
Well, the thing is right now, with the D-Dido, it just looks smoother. The death wobble right there makes you think, man, if it had got a little bit closer, it would have killed that race car.
I believe I'd
go to commercial after that explanation.
Yeah, it's highly technical. Casey Kane, still the quickest of 41 drivers who have qualified. There's Adrian Fernandez. He's headed your way. The 1995 NASCAR Busch Series champion Johnny Benson clocks in 36th in the number 67 car. 42 drivers qualified here today. We're expecting 53. Let's go back to pit road and Bob Dillner.
All right, check out the look on Elliott Sadler here. I don't know whether it's his off-season hunting look or that since we're south of Miami, his Miami Vice look, but is that going to help you out in qualifying here?
I don't know. The track's pretty slick. I'm going to do one and done. I've been around this bowl long enough. If I get in on the first lap, I got plenty of miles to race tonight to make it to the front. So the City Financial Ford is good in race trim. Was really loose in qualifying trim, so we tightened it up a bunch for today. We'll see what we got, but our main goal right now is making it to the race, and we'll race them hard tonight.
Steve, what do you think? I think it looks like a young Don Johnson.
I think it looks awesome. It's awesome. That's what Elliott says.
Speaking of awesome, on the racetrack right now, Ryan Newman in his 39 car. He was 8th quickest in practice last night.
And he looked pretty good coming to take the green. Looked like the car was up underneath him like he wanted to. Down on the bottom of the racetrack, and he's back in the throttle, digging hard to the start-finish line.
Now, he ran a 31-32 in practice. If he can pick up 3/10, he does it. 31-01. Beats Casey Kane by 2/100ths of a second on lap one.
So Ryan Newman, a threat to take his 4th pole of this season to go with 5 wins.
And that's 5 consecutive wins. Now, he did not win the last race at Texas, pretty much not stopping under caution and cycling through some green flag pit stops, pretty much beat these guys. But what a season. He only has 8 starts, and he leads the series in laps led.
Whoa!
He picks it up another 10th to 30-93.
Get you some of that.
How about that? That's going to be a tough lap to beat right there.
That's not the track record, but it is fast given the conditions here today.
And are we really surprised?
Nope.
But it's always amazing to see it.
Great job, everybody. Awesome drive, Ryan. Awesome.
Roy McCauley, the crew chief. I talked to him this morning. Right now, this team plans on running about 20 to 25 races next year. Ryan would do maybe 10 to 12 with driver unknown for the remaining part of those races.
Ryan Newman has 6 wins and 9 poles in just 23 Busch Series starts.
I'd say they wouldn't have a hard time finding a volunteer to run those other races in this race car.
No, plenty of guys raising their hands for that one. Ashton Lewis Jr. in the Marines Ford.
Have a tall order tonight. He's been fighting to try to get to the top 10 in points. Right now he's 14th, 132 points out of 10th, so that would be a tall order to get there tonight.
And a milestone for Ashton Lewis Jr. He'll make his 150th consecutive start.
He was 37th in practice last night at a 31.87.
Guys, I'll be real quick to tell you, if there's a team in the Busch Series right now, to me, that has been somewhat a surprise, a disappointing surprise, it had to be this 25 car, because I really thought that when Ashton got married up there with the Renzi operation, that this was going to be a very successful combination.
Ran for a family-owned team for the 4 previous seasons.
Now, we need to mention that lap by Ryan Newman, that took the man that finished 2nd here a year ago, who ran a 31.68, Jimmy McMurray, and it has sent him to the house. He will not race tonight.
It's pretty amazing, Larry, as you said, putting it in perspective. He finished 2nd here a year ago. McMurray did. Let's go to Marty Snyder.
Well, Ryan Newman impresses once again in qualifying, 30.93. And do you breathe during those 30 seconds, Ryan, or do you just, you know, suck it up and do it fast as you can go?
You breathe. Not knowing you breathe, but you do breathe, yeah. I come out with a little bit of color, but great run for our Alltel Dodge. Got to thank everybody at the engine company, you know, everybody at Penske Racing Run. These guys have done a great job, you know, from hanging the bodies, building the cars and everything. Just it's been a lot of fun this year, and hopefully we can finish it up the right way today.
He's been out of victory lane for one whole race, so they're going to try to get back to victory lane with a 6th win of the season, the car they won Dover and Michigan with earlier this year. Currently, he's fastest.
Busch Bowl qualifying is winding down here in Homestead. Kenny Wallace, 20th in his number 22 car. Back to pit road and Bob Dillner.
Well, Kevin Harvick has been on this inside retaining wall here at this racetrack, watching cars zoom down into turn number one. Are you learning anything?
I'm learning that the clouds are rolling in, and Ryan Newman can still go fast in qualifying. So
been pretty happy with our CVS Pharmacy Reese's Chevrolet this week, and I know you guys probably got a little bit of time here, but I want to say something in case I don't get another chance. I want to say thanks to Rusty Wallace. He's been always supportive, no matter how stupid I've been or whatever I've done wrong. He's been, you know, pretty cool guy to me and done a lot for our sport, and I know I might not get another chance. So thanks, Rusty. Appreciate everything you've done for me, and I know you've done a lot for the sport.
And of course, this weekend, Rusty's last call.
We would certainly echo that. Greg Biffle, he will be one and done, but it was a pretty stout lap. Second quickest for Greg Biffle in the 66 car.
I mean, can you imagine getting that close to Ryan Newman and not being able to quite beat him?
Well, I'll tell you this, Greg Biffle and Ryan Newman, the only two drivers to top 174 miles per hour and the only drivers under 31 seconds. See Ryan's father there, Greg.
And that's average around this mile and a half racetrack, almost 175 miles per hour.
How about Rusty Wallace last night on trackside? That was he got a little emotional talking about his farewell. He's, you know, in his own words, he's had his head in that carburetor, but I think it sort of was sinking in last night.
Slowly but surely, it will all come together. And when he wakes up on Monday morning, I'm sure he's going to be having a lot of afterthought, saying, man, did I do the right thing?
But what's been neat is watching him this year not only finish out his Nextel Cup career, but do it in a competitive fashion. Made the chase for the Nextel Cup. I know he's not been to victory lane, but he's been so close. He's been up there running at the front of the pack almost this entire 2005 season. And like I told him on trackside, regardless of the outcome today, you are a champion. Don't base this weekend on your entire career.
J.J. Yaley will move up to the Nextel Cup Series next year. He replaces Bobby Labonte.
Now, he could get to the top 10 in points. He's only 53 points out of 10th headed into this final race. And he was one of the cars that was right up there at the front in practice, fourth quickest. Let's see what he can do on this lap one. 31.46. That's going to put him 17th quickest. That's about 2.5 tenths from what he ran last night.
Not bad. This is his first attempt to qualify here at Homestead.
Had a great run at Phoenix last week. Finished in the top 10. And as we say, trying to get to the top 10 in points before this season's over with.
And just watching him go around this racetrack, guys, it looks to me like he took one of those kind of approaches of, let me just kind of ease her down in this corner on his first lap and see exactly how good my race car is, rather than trying to go out there and sit the fastest lap. Just a good, solid one.
He almost mirrors lap one with lap two, slows down just a little bit. So right now, J.J. will be 17th quickest.
Larry, I had one more thought on Rusty Wallace. One other thing, he is going out. He is a former champion, but he's going out on or at the top of his game.
Absolutely. And that's what you like to see someone doing. I know Ricky Rudd has not said the word retirement, but we know he's not going to be back full time. But Ricky Rudd has been competitive this year in the 21 Rudd Brothers car.
And one other thing you might add, too, is that I think, me personally, that the level of competition today, as Rusty starts to say, you know, farewell, is much greater. A lot more competitors with good equipment than it were back in the 80s and the 90s right there when he kind of like in his heyday. So to be able to compete at the level today that he's doing, pretty outstanding.
David Ruderman in the 98 car. Now, this will be a go-or-go-home car. And he kind of struggled in practice just a little bit yesterday. In fact, he did not run that final practice. So we'll see what he can do. But just to put a period on Ricky Rudd, when he starts his engine tomorrow in this 400-mile race, 25 consecutive years without a did not start. That is phenomenal. Most of these kids we're watching qualify here today, they were not even born when that streak started for Ricky Rudd.
Well, Larry, while you were saying about that right there, good news for Michael Walker Racing. David Ruderman just jumped up into the field 27th quickest, but bad news at the same time, he sent the boss man to the house.
Absolutely. Oops. Yeah, this was definitely the good news, bad news.
So Ruderman's first lap of 31.60, 170.837 miles per hour.
He actually picks it up just a little bit on lap two, but he'll stay right now 26 quickest.
Just five drivers remain in this qualifying session here for the NASCAR Busch Series race.
Dave Blaney, one of them in the 31 car out on the racetrack.
Once again, we have seen this in the Busch Series all year long. Right now, Ryan Newman is on the pole, and this happened to Michael a couple of weeks ago, I think at Texas. Ryan Newman's on the pole at a 30.93. Michael Waltrip just got sent to the house at a 31.64. Less than 3/4 of a second separating the pole sitter from a man that has to load up and go home.
It's just that kind of competition right now in the Busch Series that we're talking about, and each week it seems like it gets more intense. As we take a look right here at Dave Blaney, the 31 car, he's got to race his way into the field today if he wants to see the green flag drop later on this afternoon.
Jeff, you're talking about the level of competition that Rusty Wallace is walking away from being elevated. Larry Mack's point just underscores that here. There's less margin for error.
Absolutely. And, I mean, Dave Blaney, as Jeff mentioned, a go-or-go-home car, he ran a 31.58 in practice. He needs to duplicate that or actually step it up maybe a little bit. And right now, he is not there on lap one at a 31.67. He needs to pick it up about a tenth if he wants to race later on this evening.
And Larry, I know we said that we felt like that Jerry Robinson had run a lap fast enough to get in this race, but with the cloud cover coming back in and the competition that's out there, he is on the bubble right now as far as the go-go-home cars. And if Dave Blaney can pick it up a little bit, he's going to send Jerry Robinson to the house.
And he does not do it, so it looks like right now Dave Blaney will not race in his 31 car. And we've been talking about some of the holes missing in Nextel Cup. The rumor has it, not been signed yet, but Dave Blaney looks like will be going to drive that Bill Davis number 22 Nextel Cup car.
Well, Ryan Newman has four drivers yet to take a shot to see if they can knock him off the pole. We'll see who can do it. Elliott Sadler in the number 90 car making his qualifying attempt.
Now, there'll be two drivers watching Elliott Sadler. Ryan Newman will be watching him, obviously, but Jerry Robertson, we've been talking about him. We felt like when he ran that lap of 31.63, it would be good enough to be in this show, but right now, he's the bubble car. He's watching. It will either be Jerry Robertson or Elliott Sadler that will run this race later on tonight.
And Larry, I should mention, Adrian Fernandez qualified 25th in the number 5 car.
That looked like a good enough lap to get himself into this race, and it is.
31.36, that puts Elliott in this 90 car 13th quickest, and that will send Jerry Robertson with the tore-up race car to the house.
And let's see if he does what he said he was going to do, one and done. He's still coming out of the back straightaway hard.
First lap good enough for 13th.
Now this car next year plans on running the full schedule. A few races with the Elliott Sadler and driver development, Stephen Light and Matt McCall next year. So the 90 car will run the full schedule in 2006.
Now you can see Ryan Newman right there watching Elliott Sadler make his qualifying attempt. But remind me that when we talk to that boy next time, that one and done means one lap, you bring it to the garage.
I think he told us a story.
Yeah, he did. Well, I wasn't gonna, yeah, he did.
And that second lap wasn't awesome, was it?
No,
it wasn't awesome.
and something he can understand, that dog won't hunt.
Yeah. Just two drivers left. Ryan Newman just said that a second ago. Joel Kaufman, but Kevin Harvick was the last driver to go.
And you know, as we watch Joel Kaufman qualify, something that I want to make sure I say, because this will be our last on-track activity. Nextel Cup qualifying will follow us on Speed Channel with Benny and Bill and Wally. But what's so neat about what we do in the second half of Speed Channel, it's not just Speed Channel. It's not just Fox. It's a conglomeration of all of us. When you look at Matt Yoakum and Marty Snyder and Dave Burns and Bob Dillner, those guys down on pit road, and the guys in the truck that were basically NBC production, like Sam Flood, Mike Wells, Jamie Shifton, Rich O'Connor, Carlos DeMolina, Jeff Randolph. I think that shows that we are three networks as one. We are family, and I know I'm just flattered to be a part of it.
It's an honor to be here. That's a fact. You left out Pam Miller.
Pam Miller and Rick Miner, Chris Long, Frank Wilson, all the Speed Channel group. But most importantly, We want well wishes to Chuck Mills after 30 years of service and on camera number one, be retiring after this championship weekend.
Yeah, good job, Chuck Mills. And we also want to thank Alan Bester for helping us out from time to time when our buddy Steve Burns can't be around. And like I say, it's been a lot of fun the second half of the year working with everybody.
In all the hundreds of guys and girls that make these productions possible.
That is a fact. Nicely done by Joel Kaufman. In the 13th position of that number 12 car of Fitz Bradshaw Racing.
But the words we do want to utter, we will be back. Believe it or not.
Hey, is that a warning or a thing?
Hey, Larry Mack, well said on the shout-outs for all our peeps here on the broadcast team. You know where Kevin Harvick started this race from a year ago?
I know he won it. I know where he finished it.
Started it from – actually, he won the race. You're right. I started to say he started from the pole. He started 12th. So we'll see if Ryan Newman can hang on for his fourth pole in 2005, final race of the year.
He was 14th quickest in practice earlier yesterday. And he's only completed in 20 of the 34 races this year, but 13 top fives, 14 top tens, and four wins. So when this car shows up with Kevin Harvick, who plans on being in this car full-time in 2006, it's always a force to reckon with. Ryan Newman watching as Kevin Harvick completes lap 1, 31-38. Not quite there.
No, not quite there. Crew chief telling him what he's doing right there, and I think, you know, Kevin says, you know, that's about it. But watching him on that first and only lap right there, the car wiggled just a little bit in 3 and 4, and it probably took a couple tenths off his time. So Kevin says, I think that'll take care of it.
Now Ryan can really breathe.
Yeah.
Let's take a look at the Verizon fastest lap turned in by the Rocket Man, that guy, Ryan Newman.
Always fast, but the car is always so solid. He makes it look so easy when he goes down in these corners. Front end sealed off, down to the racetrack, right down on the bottom of the white line, drives it up to the outside wall. He always makes it look like, hey, child's play.
Picked up 4 tenths from what he ran in practice yesterday.
Let's hear from him, Marty.
And he was able to pick up so much time, and never hurts to start first, does it, Ryan?
Not at all, and we proved Larry Mack wrong in this one. We ran the second lap, and it did pay off for the pole. So great effort for the Alltel Dodge, and just really look forward to qualifying a Cup car as well. And again, the Busch race this afternoon, or this evening, I guess. And just really happy with everybody from Penske Racing, all the support they've given us. Alltel Dodge, Mobil, Sony, everybody's done a great job to help our Busch effort, and the guys at the shop, the guys at the Penske Jasper Engine Company are doing a great job.
How fast was the car in race trim, Ryan?
It was actually really fast. We were pretty happy with it, and you know, just didn't know what the track was going to be like today. The wind really picked up. That changed some things, especially how you drove the car, and I think that's why some guys were having problems in 1 and 2 was the wind was blowing down the front straightaway, and we'll have to see if it's like that in a race tonight.
Steve, the last time they raced this car, it sat on the pole and won at Dover.
That's a fact, Marty. 10th career pole for Ryan Newman in just 23 NASCAR Busch Series starts. The big story here, after qualifying or in qualifying, the points leader, Martin Truex Jr., crashes, has to go to a backup car.
In all the seasons, the point leader has went on to win the championship coming into this last race 22 of 23 times. So the question is, will this be 23 of 24? Are 2 of 24.
I tell you right now, I'm liking what Clint Bowyer and where he's at right now. He can put some pressure on Martin Truex. The key right now is how will this team respond? And again, we'll go back and say it again. Hey, don't beat yourself. Hopefully those guys prepared the car right as far as Martin's concerned.
Take a look at the drivers that failed to qualify. As we said, 53 drivers here. The stage is set. Martin Truex Jr. has a 64-point lead over Clint Bowyer, but he will start from the back of the pack. Thanks for being with us.